welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Mass strike held in Myanmar as military junta warns against loss of life. Anti-imperialist resistance intensifies in Haiti as protests continue against Moise regime. Workers announce general strike amid worsening economic crisis in South Africa. Vaccination campaigns and the inequities in the global COVID-19 response. Following weeks of street protests, a mass strike was held across Myanmar on February 22nd. Hundreds of thousands of people stepped out into the streets to participate in the 2-5 strike, making it among the largest demonstrations held since the military coup on February 1st. The call to strike was issued by the Burmese Civil Disobedience Movement. Businesses were shut down as workers, civil servants, and government employees joined the protest demanding the release of civilian leaders. The strike took place despite warnings issued by the military junta on the state-run MRTV broadcast. The military warned against, quote, riot and anarchy, and that the protesters were inciting people to a path where they will suffer a loss of life. Myanmar has witnessed a steady escalation of state violence against the protests. The use of tear gas, water cannons, rubber bullets, and reports of live ammunition have increased. At least 2 protesters were killed and another 20 injured after security forces used live ammunition during a protest in Mandalay on February 20th. As reported by Myanmar Now, hundreds had gathered to support striking workers from the Inland Water Transportation Department. Over a dozen protesters were detained by security forces in the capital city of Naypyidaw on Monday. As per estimates by the Assistance Association of Political Prisoners, 640 people have been arrested so far and 594 still remain in custody. Ousted State Councillor Aung San Suu Kyi and President Win Myint have also been remanded in police custody as they await the next round of hearings scheduled for March 1st. Mass protests against the regime of disputed President Jovenel Moise continued in Haiti over the weekend. Tens of thousands of people gathered in the capital of Port-au-Prince on February 21st to protest against imperialism and the US-backed Moise dictatorship. Protesters are demanding that Moise step down after illegally extending his term in office. Moise has alleged that his term in office will end on February 7th, 2022, citing discrepancies over the official start of his term. He has been ruling by decree since 2020 and has set up a committee to draft a new constitution. The Haitian opposition has agreed to set up a transitional government for 2 years and to hold fresh elections. They have also appointed Supreme Court Judge Joseph Messine Jean-Louis to serve as interim president. The protests in Haiti have also focused on and denounced the external imperialist forces lending support to the Moise regime. These include the quote core group composed of Brazil, Canada, France, Germany, the US, the Organization of American States, and representatives from the UN, among others. The support is also evident in the form of US-trained police officers that have deployed increasingly violent tactics against the protesters. Tear gas, rubber bullets, as well as reported uses of live ammunition have caused serious injuries to protesters and journalists. At least 2 protesters have also reportedly been killed so far. Romario Centralis died on February 9th after being brutally and fatally beaten by police officers on February 6th. Another person was reported to have died during the mass protest held on February 14th. Hundreds of thousands of workers across South Africa are set to down their tools as part of a mass strike on February 24th. The call to strike has been issued by the South African Federation of Trade Unions, or SAFTU. Demonstrations have been scheduled across major cities starting 9 a.m. local time. Workers will also march to the parliament in the capital of Cape Town, where the finance minister will deliver his budget speech. The general strike has been announced at a time when the working class is struggling under an economic crisis worsened by government policies. Around 2.2 million jobs have been lost in the country during the pandemic. The conditions of employment have also become increasingly insecure due to outsourcing and zero-hour contract policies. The Federation of Unions is demanding the nationalization of all strategic monopoly industries, banks, and mining houses. They are demanding that these be placed under the democratic control of workers and communities. Other key demands include a moratorium on job losses, a basic income grant of 1,500 rand, and a minimum wage of 12,500 rand. SAFTU has also called for the reimposition of a 50% wealth tax, as well as broader policies, including community healthcare and public housing for vulnerable groups. SAFTU has also demanded a just transition from a high carbon to a renewable energy-based economy. This includes job creation, protections for those currently dependent on the high carbon economy, and worker and community-based control. For our final story today, we take a look at the recent developments around COVID vaccination campaigns across the world. Amid reports of the emergence of new variants, responses to the pandemic and vaccine distribution have revealed major global inequities. Here is Dr. Satyajit Rath from the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research to talk about the politics of the global COVID response.
Only part of the answer to this question of yours is in the science and the technology. A large part of it is in the politics. And it's in the politics not simply of capitalist profit-making sector-generated vaccination. Remember that all of these vaccines that are currently out there are private sector, profit-making sector. But it's in addition to that, it's also over the past year become an apparent reality that conservative xenophobic political ideologies and governments across the world have taken advantage of fear-generated community xenophobias across the world, and therefore vaccine nationalism and in fact COVID nationalism has become yet another obstruction, I would argue, to a global community collective response to the pandemic. And in the absence of a coordinated global collective community response to the pandemic, we are going to have fragmentary responses popping up. We are going to have countries pulling at cross purposes with each other. We are going to have these situations of vaccines being returned or vaccines being demanded. We have the situation that the WHO-sponsored COVAX program to supply vaccines for underprivileged communities across the world not having enough vaccines as yet being supplied to those programs. In addition to that, we have these variants that are inevitably going to pop up. We have extremely variable variant tracking methodologies in place across the world. And we have stigmatization as a consequence of variants that is going to be prevent travel from the UK, from Brazil, from South Africa, identify those people, lock them up, and so on and so forth. In this extraordinary coordination of capitalism and xenophobia, it's a little hard to make optimistic predictions about how well life for the ordinary people of the world is going to return to normal. Let us stay with the community norm of physical distancing and masking. Let us acknowledge that the vaccines are safe, because the evidence is that the vaccines are safe, and therefore let us not give in to vaccine anxieties and take vaccine shots as and when they become available. And let us keep pressing our governments for better public health system investment, resources, vaccine rollout, and variant tracking. More than that.
And this is all the time we have in this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website, peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.